Welcome to worship here at Somerset Hills Lutheran Church. And a special shout out to those online. Good morning and welcome. And for those of you who are online, we would appreciate if you'd say hi in the chat and at least give us a head count of who's with you and if there's more than one, just so we can keep track. And also go ahead and chat and say hi to your neighbors and friends and the conversation going in the background. We won't hear you. If you do have prayer requests, though, you can put them in the chat, and we will bring them forward to our pastors to lead us in prayer. All right, what do we got going on here? Every Wednesday during Lent, we managed to keep some tradition. ...20-25 minutes, and we study the Bible verses or gospel or something that's coming up in that next week in Lent and on a Sunday. And we study that with the elders or Pastor John, and basically we just give you a little insight into some of the readings that are coming up. So it's a real nice informal thing. We pray for each other and then go. You don't have to speak. I'm just saying it's a small group. If anybody wants to give feedback, they can, but you can just listen and enjoy the devotions. That's every Wednesday. It's online. Look for it in our communications. And if you saw the slides or the pictures that came out, but special thanks to all who contributed to the food drive for Plainfield High School. The kids in Plainfield were collecting food, and we participated. And Becky Johnson, in particular, coordinated our efforts from our church and other people. Of course, all of you contributed, so we appreciate that. We saw pictures of Jan helping load, so that's great. Let's see. Wow. Hey, it's I think March is, what do they call it, Women's Something Month? I don't know. I heard that. But anyway, speaking of women, the Lutheran Women's Missionary League, that's our women's league group, is doing some special work. And let's see, what are we doing here? They support missions all over the world. They always have, and they continue to do that. And in what we kick off in the spring is, it's called a mite drive. You know, they have these boxes, the physical boxes, of course, in a virtual world, you can give mites in a virtual way as well. I don't know if they have an online box, but anyway, you could just keep in mind that, you know, any of your small donations, big donations, you can throw into your mite box, and they'll be collected. Well, we're going to collect ours here on March 28th. So bring yours or send it online. Do whatever you can. That'd be fantastic. Let's see. Easter's coming up. So also on March 28th is the deadline. If you'd like to donate flowers for the sanctuary in honor of anybody or just to praise the Lord, you can donate flowers here. And it'll beautify the altar area here, whether you're in person or you visualize it online. If you want to send a donation for that purpose, just write Altar Guild. It's our Altar Guild. There's the fine people that will make sure those flowers get here. And I think that's it. And with that, it's my great pleasure to bring our Pastor John Trinkline.
Thank you, and good morning to you. Is the microphone working? All right, good. To you online and you who are here in person, yes, I'm Pastor John Trinkline. I get to be the intentional interim pastor with you at Somerset Hills Lutheran Church and be part of what God is doing in this place. Now, today we're going to learn that as baptized children of God, we have been given access to go boldly into the presence of the Lord, to enter into his presence with all of our cares and concerns. And that he hears us and he answers us. That great privilege is called prayer. So today we're beginning a two-part sermon series on prayer today. And then on March 21st, I'll have the second part as we look at the Lord's Prayer. So may we open our ears and our hearts that we may learn how to pray as Jesus teaches us. Let's stand together, and we begin with the invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In life, we will face difficult choices. Let us pause to reflect on how we often wrongly respond, and how God, in his mercy, has been faithful to his promises. a moment of silence. Heavenly Father, we confess that when we find ourselves facing hard situations, we often choose what's easiest and most comfortable for us, rather than seeking your way. We confess that often we seek our own glory rather than your glory. We are selfish and tend to keep our things for ourselves rather than sharing with those in need. Lord, forgive our doubt and fear and help us do the hard things in life according to your will. Amen. Our loving Heavenly Father has heard our cry for mercy and sent his Son to be our Savior. He suffered and died for you and me so that we might be restored in our relationship with God. So be at peace. Your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's respond as we give praise to God in the song.
You alone are my my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. I want you more than gold or silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Good morning. The scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs, and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For through the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The gospel reading for today is from John chapter 2. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." They replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please join me in the affirmation of faith as printed on the screen and in the order of service. I believe in the wonderful mystery of the Holy Trinity, the Father Almighty, the Son, our glorious Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, who works in us and through us. Together, they are the one true God. I believe I have been born again by the power of the Holy Spirit and faith in Jesus Christ, whose blood atoned for my sins, forever reconciling me with the Father. I believe that God has a purpose for me and will equip me to carry out his work in this world before one day bringing me home to eternal life with him. I believe I can do all things through him, and without him, I can do nothing. This I believe and confess. Amen.
Be seated at this time. And I'm going to have a children's lesson, so any of the kids here that are willing to come up, we'll keep a little distance with us, but you can sit in front and I'll stay over here. Looking forward to sharing with you. All right, Christus. Oh, look. This is awesome. Couple of my favorite friends. I'm so glad to see you. And I'm going to stay back and I'll take this off so I can talk a little easier. Did you know that some people have what's called a prayer list? Have you ever heard of that? A prayer list? It's kind of like a grocery list. Has your mom and dad ever made a grocery list? They have? Okay, so you know what that is. Maybe today they use their phone. That's what I do. I put it in my phone and then I go in and get my groceries. But used to be you made a list. Now, I have a grocery list like this. Look, this is apples and vegetables, chicken, blueberries, fish. Now, one of these grocery lists, because I have a second one, one of these mom made and the other the kids made. Now, here's the other one. It says ice cream, candy, cake, potato chips, cookies. You have any idea which one the kids made? Any idea? Yeah? Yeah, what would you like? Which list do you like better? The cakes and the cookies? All right. I saw you looking at that one. And you're right. Mom made this one, though, because mom knows you need to have some really healthy food, like vegetables and chicken. Nothing wrong with cookies and ice cream. But if it's all you eat, I don't think that's a good idea, right? So I have a prayer list here. These are things you could pray for. We can pray for things like, this one says, parents, friends, grandparents, myself, yes. You can. You can pray for God to bless and to be with you and just give him your thanks, right? That's awesome. I even put on here, you can pray for your brother or sister. Yeah, you could. Yeah. But there's something missing because Well, God has something to say about our prayer list. Let me read to you a passage. This is 1 Timothy 2. And it says, I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people, for those who are in authority, for this pleases God. So we need to add something to our list. We need to add all people. And God says, when you pray, I want you to pray for all people. Now, that could be people like this. It could be hungry people, lonely people, the president, firemen, firewomen, people who don't know Jesus. Maybe you have a friend that doesn't know Jesus, and you could pray for them that they would know Jesus. And so you see, this is what God says we should pray for. And today we're going to learn from Jesus, why should we pray and how should we pray? But remember, let's look at God's list. We can pray for everybody. And in fact, let's do that right now. What do you say? I'm going to fold my hands and we're going to have a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us so much and you sent Jesus to be our Savior. And now we pray for all people. We pray for those who are alone. We pray for those who are hurting. We pray for those who are hungry. And we pray for those who don't know that you are the God who saves us through Jesus. Thank you for all the gifts you give us of family and friends and everything else. But we pray that we may do what you tell us to do and see you work in ways that we can't even imagine. So thank you for hearing us, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen. That was quite something. All right, go back and don't forget, keep on praying, all right? We'll continue with the next song.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing I will fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me by your side, and I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto.
Hunger for you and your will, and that we would become a people who learn how to pray. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a story, it's from a couple centuries ago, of a young man who wanted to take a transatlantic journey on a ship to the United States or to America. And it took all the money that he had to buy this ticket. And so he figured he's not going to be able to afford to eat in the dining hall on the ship. So he took cheese and crackers and apple and bread along with him. And now this is a 2 to 3 week journey to go across the Atlantic. And it was towards the end of the voyage that a man noticed him over there eating cheese and crackers and now stale bread. And he said to him, why don't you come into the dining room? There's a huge banquet. I mean, and this young man, he would see all of that feast that was in there. I mean, food that was beyond his wildest imagination. And embarrassed, the young man said, well, you see, I took all my money to buy the ticket. I know I can't afford the food. And the other traveler looked at him and said, what do you mean? The food is included in your ticket. It's already been paid for. Can you imagine, huh? Do you know that there are a lot of believers who are going through life that are missing out on one of the greatest feasts you could ever imagine? That is to have this fellowship with the living God, to know him in a way that is very personal, and to feed on the riches of what he gives to us in Jesus. You see, this privilege that we're given is a privilege called prayer. I would say one of the greatest tragedies in life are the unanswered prayers because they were never even asked. So today I will tell you right up front, as we look at a series that I got this week and then 2 weeks from today, as we look at prayer, I will tell you that my desire is that you'll either discover or rediscover and engage in prayer, powerful prayer, where you come before the living God and you know that he desires to work in your life. So today is the introduction to the Lord's Prayer, and then I will look specifically at the Lord's Prayer on March 21st. So let me ask you this question. How and where did you learn how to pray? How many of you learned some of the memorized prayers? For example, the Common Table Prayer. Anybody know that one here? Yeah, you know, come Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let, oh, this is where controversy comes, right? Because some people say, let these gifts, some people say, let thy gifts, and the compromisers, you know what they say? Let these thy gifts to us be blessed, okay? So there's that Common Table Prayer. How about the Nighttime Prayer? You remember that one? Anybody have this one? Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And if I should die, well, you know, actually that was very disturbing to me as a child. So let's just stop right there with that one. And then there's the Lord's Prayer. How many of you could verbatim say the Lord's Prayer? How many could do that? All right, you could. You know, I believe that these words, the combination of these words, are probably spoken more than any other words in all of history. It would be the Lord's Prayer. It's very familiar, and we say it every Sunday, don't we? And maybe that's part of the problem. We get so familiar with it, we just forget the power and the beauty and the majesty of this prayer. So we need to be able to get a handle on what's really going on. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus is inviting you to know the Creator, the Almighty God, that he welcomes you and loves you, that he listens to you, that you can bring before him anything. You can pour out your heart. You can tell him about your fears, your battles, your hurts, your failures, your needs. All of this you can do with confidence. And if you're a little nervous about that, let me tell you something. God already knows everything about you. Do you know that he is the one person? God is three persons and one God, but he is the one that you can't hide anything from him. He knows everything about you, the good and the bad, and yet he invites you into prayer. Let me tell you my story of learning how to pray. I learned the table prayer, the prayer to go to bed at night. There were other prayers, the Lord's Prayer. I learned those growing up. But it wasn't until I went to college. It was one of our Lutheran colleges, Concordia University in Ann Arbor, Michigan. which, by the way, is a great way to meet your future spouse. I'm just saying, just so you know that, is at one of our Lutheran colleges. Okay, so anybody out there is listening? And I had a history professor who, when it came to teaching history, I have to be honest, he was really boring, okay? He couldn't even look at us students. He would lecture, and I think he probably couldn't stand to see that most of the students were falling asleep. So he'd either look at his toes, or he'd look at the ceiling. But then that history professor gave an invitation. He said, if any of you students would like to join me on Wednesdays at noon in the chapel, I have prayer time, and I would love for you to come and join me in prayer. Well, only me and two other students took him up on this, but I did. I went to see what this was about. I did not expect what happened would happen. I heard this man just talk to God. It was just a conversation. I'd never really heard conversational prayer before. And he would ask us how we're doing, and then he would go into prayer, and he prayed for us as students. He would pray that God would be with us. He would pray for our future. I also remember that he would pray about his daughter. He was very concerned about his daughter, that she would indeed know the true God and not drift away from him. It was in this context that I learned how to just have conversational prayer. Oh, I had to grow in it, but I began to get to the point where it was just talking with God. And so you see, that's how I learned about prayer. And here's what I want you to know. That why do we pray? Why? And I'll tell you, because God commands it. Okay, that's the first thing. God commands it. Psalm 50:15 says, call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall glorify me. God actually tells us, I want you to enter into prayer. I command it when you're in trouble. Look to me and watch what I will do. You just heard 1 Timothy 2:1 in the children's lesson, but it says, I urge you, first of all, that prayers, requests, intercession, thanksgiving be made for everyone. First of all, pray is what it's saying. First of all, that means there's a sense of urgency about our prayer, but it also is talking about a sense of priority. Let it be the first thing you do, not the last thing you do. So we tend to think prayer is the last resort. I mean, there's a story about a little country church out in the middle of nowhere, and they're having church, and they got news that a tornado was headed right for the church. And so the pastor said, let's pray. And one of the members said, oh no, has it come to this? They think that prayer is the last resort. No, it's the first response that we need to learn is to move into prayer. It goes on in 1 Timothy chapter 2. It says, we're to pray for kings and all in authority that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. For this is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved, to come to the knowledge of truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. I want you to make a connection here. First of all, pray for everybody, including those in authority, but for everybody. And there's a connection between that and what God wants to see happen, and that is that everyone would come to know his grace. Pray for open doors. Pray for God to move in a powerful way. So why do we pray? First of all, because God commanded it. But let me tell you the other reason. We pray because we need it. We do, don't we? I'm kind of like the guy who prayed, Father, today I haven't spoken any harmful words to anybody. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. I haven't been greedy or selfish. But I'm about ready to get out of bed. So I could really use your help. I can relate to that guy. We need it. We need God's help. And what I find interesting about Jesus is that his disciples looked at how he lived his life And they realized that prayer was a huge part of his life. And so they said, Lord, would you teach us how to pray? That's in Luke chapter 11, verse 1. And so we'll take a look at that. It says, one day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. You know what I find fascinating? Nowhere did Jesus say to his disciples, okay, you guys, there's a thing called prayer. You got to learn about it. I rented a room at the temple. I'm going to lecture on it for the next 4 weeks so you learn how to pray. He didn't do that. He lived a life of prayer. They saw that. While there were times that Jesus got up before everybody else did, they couldn't find him. And where was he? He was spending time in the presence of the Heavenly Father. We're told there were times when he spent the whole night in prayer. He did that when he selected his disciples. We're told that when he saw or encountered people in their need, he would pray. There was a deaf man who could not speak. And the Lord prayed. Sight of prayer, and he healed him. And the people were hungry and had nowhere to go because they had been listening to Jesus teach all day. Before he did a miracle of feeding the 5,000, he said a prayer. And so the disciples thought, well, if this is important to Jesus, it ought to be important to us. We must really need prayer. And so they said to Jesus, would you teach us how to pray? You see, for Jesus, prayer was not a religious ritual, an obligation, something you have to do. You don't just repeat it over and over and over mindlessly. No, prayer was his fellowship, his time with the Father. And in Luke chapter 11, verse 1, I'm going to skip over to verses 9 and 10 of Luke, where Jesus said this, and I tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, it will be opened. I want you to see the intensity growing in this. You ask, you seek, you knock. Ever gotten to that point where you just say, God, I'm knocking. I have nowhere else to go. I need you. Yeah, we need prayer. And you know what? It doesn't have to be eloquent words. You don't have to get real theological about this. You don't have to say, oh, almighty. And you don't have to change your voice, by the way. Oh, almighty, omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent Father. The reality is your helplessness is your best prayer. Your helplessness. A woman whose daughter was fighting demons in her life came to Jesus, and here's what she said, Lord, help me. And he healed the daughter. Peter, remember walking on the water? Because Jesus had invited him to come and walk on the water, and then Peter started to sink, and he didn't then concoct this amazing prayer. He just said, help me. And the Lord reached out and saved him. Your helplessness is your best prayer. You know that? Dr. Hallesby, one of Norway's leading Christian teachers and seminary professors from the mid-20th century, wrote a book entitled Prayer. It is a classic. I have learned so much from this man through his writings on prayer. Listen to this. To pray is nothing more involved than to let Jesus into our needs. To pray is to give Jesus permission to employ his powers in the alleviation of our distress. To pray is to let Jesus glorify his name in the midst of our needs. The results of prayer are therefore not dependent upon the power of the one who prays. His intense will, his fervent emotions, or his clear comprehension of what he is praying for are not the reasons why his prayers will be heard and answered. God be praised, the results of prayer are not dependent on any of these things. To pray is nothing more involved than to open the door, giving Jesus access to our needs and permitting him to exercise his power in dealing with them. Is that powerful? It's God's power. It's our privilege. It's all about him, and we pray. So your helplessness is your best prayer, but trusting God's faithfulness is your best answer to prayer, that you just trust him. Now, can you trust him? You can if you know how much he loves you and what he has done for you. Romans chapter 8 puts it this way. If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. By the way, if anybody ever tries to condemn you, you don't forget that. It's God who justifies. Who can bring anything against you? Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who is raised to life, get this, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Did you know that Jesus, in his resurrected glory, is interceding and praying for you? You would think he'd want to just sit back and relax a little bit, wouldn't you? But here is the Almighty resurrected Savior and Lord praying for you. So what is prayer? Prayer is the continuation of a conversation that was started by God. It's part of a continuing conversation started by God. That's prayer. You see, God is speaking to us. The reason we pray is it's a response to God. Prayer is not some human fear or imagination that says, I need some divine being out there, so I'll make up one so that I can pray to it. That's not how it works. No, prayer is the result of a living God who has spoken his word into this world. How does he speak to us? Well, many ways he speaks to us. It's just people aren't listening to him. One way he speaks is through creation itself. Look at its beauty, its complexity. Look at the design of our universe. Look at the laws of physics that he has put into place. Here is God saying, I am here. You have a creator God who cares about you. He is called our Heavenly Father. God speaks to us through other people. Have you ever noticed that? Have you ever had a conversation with someone and they're saying something to you and you realize, wait a second, this isn't just my friend saying something. God is piercing my heart. He's got a word for me in the middle of what my friend is saying to me. The most clear way he speaks to us is through the Bible. That's a no-miss kind of thing. He speaks to us through the Word of God. Because that word is his word to us. And because prayer is initiated by God speaking to us, here's what I can tell you. Almost everybody prays. Even those that don't really know who he is. Muslims pray 5 times a day. Jews pray 3 times a day. The Buddhists, they have these prayer wheels that's supposed to fling out prayers into the atmosphere. I don't know how that's working for them. There are Hindus who pray. They pick out whatever God they decide and pray. Even those people who are not religious, even people who are not religious pray. Did you know that? There was a study done in 2004. And they found that nearly 30% of atheists admitted to praying. Now think of that. Atheists don't believe there's a God. And yet 30% said, yeah, I found myself praying. And 17% of non-believers in God pray regularly. Fascinating, isn't it? And the truth is, you need to know the true and living God. And he has been revealed to us through the scriptures. You see, the better we know God, the better our prayer life will be. It's like a relationship. If you don't know somebody very well, what do you find? The conversation is superficial. It doesn't really get to the core of what your life is about or where you're going. But if you know someone who's a trusted friend, then anything's possible as you share with one another. And as I said to you earlier, there is nothing hidden from God. He knows everything about you. So don't pretend in front of him. Just be the real you and let him minister to you in the places you need him the most. So what does that prayer look like? Ephesians 6:18 says, "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people." So I want to look at two things. First of all, with all kinds of prayer. There's all kinds. Prayer can be a memorized prayer. Prayer can be in the church, and we're praying the Lord's Prayer. That's the best prayer of all. You can know that God hears that prayer. Jesus taught us to pray that way. But it can also be a thought that you lift up to the Lord. Or you're in the grocery store and you say a word of blessing to the person who is checking you out. And so you have that blessing. There's all kinds of forms of prayer. It could be a simple help that is directed to the Lord. And then it says, always keep on praying. So you don't stop. Actually, that's what Jesus said. In the words, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be open to you. The verb actually means keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. Let it be a lifestyle, a daily thing for you to keep praying. And then watch what God's going to do. Get ready. Let me finish the story about my history professor. 20 years later, I'm a pastor. I'm headed to Russia, where we're going to work in a new church that was planted and in orphanages. I have my team with me, going with me, a mission team. We made an unscheduled stop in Prague. It was kind of a bother, but it's what we had to do for whatever reason. And while we're sitting there on the tarmac in Prague, some of my team members came up to me and started talking to me. When this woman sitting in front of me turned around and she said, "What kind of trip are you on?" I said, "It's a mission trip." I told her, "We're going to work in the orphanages. We're going to work with the church." I said, "I'm a Lutheran pastor, so I've got a team here with me." She said, "What kind of Lutheran are you?" I said, "Well, you seem to know more about Lutherans than a lot of people. Why would you know more about Lutherans?" She said, "Because my dad was a professor at one of the Lutheran colleges." I said, "Really? What did he teach?" "He taught history." I said, "Your dad was my professor." I said, "Tell me, what are you doing?" She says, "I'm here for a medical trip. We have a team going over." I said, "Really? Is this a mission trip?" She said, "Oh, no, I'm not a believer. This is just a medical exchange." I looked at her and I said, "Knowing your dad the way I do, tell me, why are you not a believer?" She said, "When I was a teenager, it was the whole creation evolution thing, and I just can't buy into believing that God created the world. I mean, evolution seems to be more scientific." Now, I am not the smartest guy in the world. I'll tell you that right up front. But do you know what book I happen to be reading on this flight just before this conversation? Is a book by a man named Scott Hughes, and it was on creation and evolution. I said, "Well, what is it about creation you have a problem with?" She said, "It's the length of time. It couldn't have happened that fast." I gave her some illustrations where actually science was more supportive of creation than the idea of billions of years for these things to happen. And as I shared those things with her, you could just see the conversation got a little more engaged, a little more back and forth. And she said, "Well, the DNA thing, I can't go with that." And I shared with her some scientific evidence why it is that we started not with simplicity out of primordial slime, but we started with complexity with the DNA that was created in us. And it got really intense at that point. And she looked at me and she said, "Now you're starting to sound like my dad." And she turned around. I could tell she did not want to talk. Before she turned around, I did say this, because only the Holy Spirit could have given me. She said, now you're starting to sound like my dad. And only the Holy Spirit could have done this. I looked at her and I said, why do you think I'm sitting here in a plane in Prague talking to you about God except for the prayers of your dad? And she turned around. And I realized there's been a dad praying for his daughter for years. And I just began in my heart to agree with her father's prayer. God, would you reach her heart? Would you help her to know you are the living God and Savior, that Jesus is the one who laid down her life for her. I don't know why it took me so long, but it was about 5 years later, I thought, I need to call my professor. He was already retired. He moved to Arizona. I don't know why people, you know, go to Arizona when they retire. Have you figured that out? And I told him that I met his daughter on the plane. I told him the story. I said, can you give me an update on Kristen? He said, funny thing that you should ask. For the first time in years, she said, Dad, I'm going to come visit you for Easter. Could I come to church with you? So the professor and I prayed on the phone, praying for Kristen. Always keep on praying. All kinds of prayer. God is speaking all the time. There are people around you who need God at work in their lives, and we get to partner with God in prayer. There's a writer who says something I think is very important. He says, do not say you'll pray about a thing. Pray about it. Don't you like that? Because have you ever had the case where somebody said, oh, I need you to pray, and you say, yeah, I'll pray for you. And then you see them next week and they say, thank you for praying. God heard my prayer. And you just want to crawl under a table or chair because you know you didn't pray. So don't say you'll pray about a thing. Pray about it. I will tell you, there have been so many times when I said, let's pray right now. Just do it right now and watch God work. Why pray? God commands it. We need it. Watch what he'll do. So let's at this time come before the Lord with our prayers. What do you say? That we would reach out to him, that he would hear our prayers. And yes, as a family of God, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer this day as well. In our prayers, as they're listed out, we come before our Heavenly Father. Would you in your hearts agree with and join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this great privilege. And we are coming before you in the name of Jesus, not because of who we are, but because of what you have done for us and your love for us. We pray for those who need a touch of your healing hand, as I name before you, Jenny and Joe, Finley, Javidka, Elda, Lucas, Ellen, Joanne, Kathy, Ellen, and for Glavsir, who's recovering from surgery. He's the father of a friend of one of our dear members. Lord, we pray also for your continuing comfort with Jody Kokenge at the death of her mother. And thank you for the promise of the resurrection to eternal life. And be with Jody and her entire family. We pray for our Gentle Shepherd Christian Preschool, Lord, especially as the two-year-old class is having to quarantine. And Lord, we just pray your health, your strength, your blessing and provision. Be with the families. Be with these children. We are so thankful that they're hearing the message of the gospel. And I just pray indeed these children will have that spirit-born faith in them that they will always have for the rest of their lives. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray for our leaders, our president, our governor, all the leaders, Lord, the civil servants. They can't do what they do without your guidance, Lord. So we pray indeed that they would have open hearts and be receptive to the truth that you bring to them. Thank you, Lord, for those celebrating birthdays. And we give you joy because you give us the gift of life. As I name before you, Heather Christian, Michael Myers, and Joanne Spoler. And Lord, Joanne is our member of the week. Help us to reach out to her, send a letter, contact her, let her know that we love her as part of our family in this place. And now, it is the family of God that together we pray the prayer that our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus, indeed, he intercedes for us, but he has given us a very tangible gift where he gives us himself. It's so simple and yet so amazing of the love of our Savior. Aren't you glad he made it so simple? It's bread and wine that he gives us, his body and blood. Aren't you glad it's not an expensive champagne and caviar? Aren't you glad it's so accessible that our Savior gives himself to you and me? You see, in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." After the supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood for the remission of all your sins." As we're about to commune together, brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Take the elements, first the bread, and open that up. And together as a family of God, we will receive this communion. And those of you at home who are joining us, take and eat the body of Christ, broken into death for you. Opening up the wine. Take and drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, strengthen and preserve you in the true faith until that day when Jesus says to you, "Welcome home, my child." God is so good, so gracious to us, isn't he? And all of his blessings. So now, let me give to you the benediction of our Lord. Why don't you stand for the blessing? Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the immediate power and presence of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. We close with our song of praise.
Upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand. The soul that on Jesus has leaned for repose, I will not desert to it. his foes, and so through all hell should endure to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. When through fiery trials your pathway will lie, my grace all sufficient will be your supply. The flames will not hurt you, I only design your dross to consume and your gold to refine. Throughout all their life, time my people will prove my sovereign, eternal, unchangeable love. And then when gray hairs will their temples adorn, like lambs they will still in my bosom be born. Amen.
Amen.